Good evening, we'll come to order. This is the third public meeting of the Board of Commissioners, 2016.
Thanks.
Today is Monday, February 1st. The Board of Commissioners met in a executive session to discuss a personnel matter, a real estate matter, and a legal matter. Mr. Gentile, will you please take the roll?
I will. Mr. D'Amelio.
Present.
Mr. McCluskey.
Here.
Mr. Siegel.
Here.
Mr. Lewis.
Here.
Mr. Holmes.
Here.
He is here. Mr. McGarrity.
Here.
Mr. Wexler.
Here.
Mr. Levy.
Here.
And Mr. Connell.
Here. Chief, could you please do pledge allegiance?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And Chief, since you're up, could we play the crime report, please, first on the agenda?
January of 2016, phone scams. As you well know, this will really go on next month's report, but I wanted to bring it up again because I've spoken and sent emails to most of the commissioners. We had 20 phone scams in the past 5-6 days. They have since dropped off. They are the IRS phone scams. Everybody's aware of those, and we put a phone blast out. We made sure it got on the internet. We put it on Facebook and everything else. So, and it's not just us suffering from it. Most of Delaware County is getting whacked with it. So it's our concern is that some people will fall into that trap and send money to these scams.
Chief, can I talk more about that? I received one myself.
So did I.
So did I.
Yeah. I had got a call today from a constituent who received one about his computer.
Microsoft.
Yeah.
Microsoft scam.
My question is, and what confuses me as an American, as a citizen, how are these offshore companies getting our phone numbers? Who is selling them numbers?
They're not selling them. They're just getting them from the internet. It's public information.
So that's the only way they're getting these?
Go onto these websites and do automated phone calls. They just continually call one phone number after the other.
Yeah,
they just go right down. So like you get robocalls for elections, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. So the only way they're getting is through the internet?
Yep.
And why are they not traceable?
Because they're sent through a phony or through another website. So you can go on your computer right now and bring one of those websites out and call somebody and show it as a different phone number automatically.
But are we sure? Because there are companies that sell phone numbers out to other companies for solicitation purposes. I mean, is there any way the government is tracking this? How is the government allowing this to continue?
Well, obviously the IRS is on it. They have put public service announcement. They also have a website to track these calls. It's gotten that bad. But we ourselves have tried to backtrack them. We have called those phone numbers, and after 20 minutes or so, those phone numbers go away and a new phone number arrives. So it's very, 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 if not impossible, to get to the bottom of it. Believe me, we have tried.
I had a woman today who called me and said that they had a warrant, that the IRS had a warrant for her arrest.
That's exactly
and she
what
wanted
said.
To she wanted to know if you know what was going on. I said, "There's no warrant for your arrest, ma'am. I'm positive."
It says we're sending the police to pick you up.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Yeah.
Mine said the exact same thing. So.
Yeah. And it's very important that people know that.
And that Microsoft scam is the same thing they get into your computer.
Well, it's Microsoft, and they also do it representing themselves as Dell.
Right.
And the Dell, because we've gotten a slew of them at my house, actually says Dell in the caller ID, and if you call it back, they answer that. But Dell does not call you, nor does Microsoft, ever, unless you have initiated a call or a service call, because they do not do that, so the public needs to know, because then they put malware on, and then they take over your computer, and then it's a ransom to get it back.
Nor does the IRS ever make a phone call to your house. They will send you official documents. So we urge everyone, Lois, I know you've had it in the paper before, we get it out there, that any of these IRS calls or Microsoft calls or Dell calls are phony calls. Don't fall for them, please. So, all right, so in January, we wrote 231 traffic citations, 117 parking tickets, 216 written warnings. We had 4 burglaries, a public storage. It was entry via stored employee key. $1,000 was taken. Vermont Road, an open basement door. TV was taken. Glen Arbor Road, unknown entry. We think a sliding door was unlocked. They took $300 in cash. And Aubrey Avenue front door was kicked in. unknown if entry was even made into the house. We had an attempt on January 25th on Park Road. Doorknob was removed from the front door, but nobody got in. Theft from vehicles, that was the other issue we dealt with last month, and we've dealt with this before also. All unlocked cars, and we had 24 cars in from the 9th to the 21st that were entered. None of them were locked. Most of them were cash. There was GPS, some computers taken, credit cards. So once again, we urge everyone, they must lock their cars, unlock cars, and we have one car stolen with the keys were in it also. So we ask that the people lock their cars. We had one report of a sex offense on the 12th of January. It was unfounded. We found it took place in another jurisdiction, Montgomery County. Canine usage, we had 7 canine usages at a house search on attempted burglary. We tracked a retail theft and arrest, alarm and a house search, open door with a house search, a track for an attempted burglary, a search warrant, service for narcotics, and domestic situation.
Thank you. Okay, thank you very much. Next, Tony.
Actually, could I ask the chief something?
Yep. Okay, chief.
With regard to the snowstorm we had last week, was there any issues involving enforcement of, you know, people pushing snow into the streets and all that kind of stuff?
There certainly was. There was multiple enforcement actions during the snowstorm. As you know, in the past few years, we have been warning and citing. This year was everyone got cited if the police actually saw them, whether it be a private plow person or a resident putting snow in the street, they were cited. So when the police saw it, we did cite them. If in fact it was a business and we found that the snow was in the street from that business, the property owner was cited. So we had multiple enforcement actions on that. And there was a lot of snow, no place to put it. So the township was doing a great job. They come down a plow street. Next thing you know, there was a pile of snow out there. So at Mr. Gentile's request, over the past few years, we have been enforcing that ordinance.
Good.
So when you cite them, that doesn't mean is that the warning or is that actually a fine?
That's well, just like anything else, we issue the citation, then they can either pay
they
for
cure.
It or plead not guilty and go to court.
Oh, so it is an actual citation?
Correct, yes.
And how many did you issue?
Larry, do you remember?
I think there was 18.
18 or 20. There was a couple units. There was probably about 20 altogether.
Do we have any statistics as to citations that are issued and where they're challenged and they're overturned by the magistrate?
We don't have that yet because anybody who has asked for a hearing probably hasn't even come up yet. So okay, we'll try and get the information.
I would be interested in that information.
Steve, last year's citation, 75% of them were upheld.
Were upheld and 25% were dismissed?
Yes.
What are we doing for properties that are vacant or potentially being rented and no one comes in and clears the snow from their walkways?
Or that code usually takes care of that on that matter.
Yeah. So. I've had that a couple places and Joe comes out and he cites them, and they either clear it or they get fined.
We have to call, though, right? If they see it, they'll deal with it, right?
Yeah, they call codes or they call one of us.
We have a lot of that lately happening.
Yeah.
That's not the same process as the grass issue, right? Because I know the grass issue can take 30 days for a turnover. If it's sidewalk and it's 24 hours, will the township go out and to do it because of the 24-hour issue, and then charge the
owner? If we had to, we would lien the property. I got to tell you, I don't think we've had any incidents that we were asked to do that. This was a challenging storm, obviously, for everyone, not only the us as a municipal government, but for the residents. And it took us probably 3 days to get all of our sidewalks up to par. To where they need to be, and I don't recall getting any calls from codes. In fact, I know I didn't get any calls from codes for any of those vacant properties. So either the neighbors did them or someone came out and had them done.
What's the cost of that citation?
It's up to $300 fine, I believe. The judge doesn't have to assess that full amount. That's obviously his discretion.
Any more questions? Chief, thank you very much.
Well, let me just say I'd like to thank Peggy Kane because she called me about the about the situation with the IRS. And the bottom line is she did the right thing for the people sitting out in the audience and for the people on TV. She called 911, and that dispatcher told her, well, it's a scam. He told her straight out it's a scam, and he also said, notify your local police department, which I did. And, of course, I notified Larry, and he put out the call about that. So
that's what I told the constituent tonight, but I don't know if they're calling the police. Is it just being reported, right? There's nothing else much you can do.
There's not a whole lot we can do, Commissioner. That's correct. But like anything else, we like to keep track of these things to see how far they are. Hopefully, at some point, the federal government can track this back. So no matter what incident happens, any event, we always ask the person to call 911 so we can have a report of it.
Right. I just think the federal government needs to look at it.
I really think they have, but it's really
Americans are being taken for, I've seen on the news, thousands of dollars. In fact, recently, an older senior citizen told me that he got a call saying his grandson was arrested in, Guatemala, and he needed money for bail, and then he sent bail money, and then they said they lost the paperwork and they needed some more money. This guy sent thousands of dollars.
Correct. The scam is they make them go get a green dot card to go buy, and then they send the money to her.
Yeah, but the point I was making, though, Steve, is the fact that this lady followed the procedure that we need the people to follow and by calling 911.
I get it, and I told it was Jim Romano, actually. I told him to call the police. Just let the police know about it.
And I think the police department did a good. I mean, that's our goal, is to continue as we hear these things that get, and we have the tools and technology now through social media and our reverse 911 system to get this message out, and that's why it's important that we continue to ask our residents to if they haven't received these automated calls from the township, to go onto our website. It literally takes less than 5 minutes to do it, and it's the emergency notification. So I think our system now, we're up to 25,000 numbers.
So we know about the IRS scam, the Microsoft scam. Dan, are you saying that they put something on your computer?
Yeah, they call and say they're servicing your Windows. And then they want to access it. They use common software. I mean,
and they get in your computer and hijack it.
Then they put in malware or ransomware. Typically ransomware, because that will freeze the computer, and the only way you can get access to your data is to pay the money. And that's very common, but they do it under both Microsoft and Dell. And well, I see it a lot because of my clients.
I mean, I would hope that it's just random, that they're just getting these numbers, and it's not a U.S. company selling phone numbers of United States citizens overseas to these companies. I hope it's not the case.
I think it's important that people report it, only even if it's just so that the rest of the public can be warned, so the police can send out these warnings to people. So it's important that this get reported.
Okay. If we can move on then. The demonstration that you have down there for Mr. Pannoni for the traffic adaptive system, it's that triangle there for Westchester Pike, Darby Road, and Township Line Road. We're going to move that demonstration actually to better weather in the spring, fall, or in the spring, summer time. Is that correct, Mr. Pannoni?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. Next on the discussion, the work session agenda is discussion for Ordinance P1 2016. This was at the request last month by Commissioner Wexler to put this on for discussion, parking of trucks and commercial vehicles, and it is the it is actually about amending the language for parking of trucks and commercial vehicles. Commissioner Wexler, I will.
Well, we have talked about this, both Commissioner D'Amelio, Commissioner Siegel, myself, for the last 4 years. We have a problem with enforcement. Our police, we've been making laws block by block on parking regulations, none of which get enforced because you can't expect our police officers to drive down a block, go look up an ordinance per block, or look for a sign that might have been faded. So what we've talked about, all of us, over the last 4 years is some type of township-wide regulation like the other townships do. And I think Commissioner D'Amelio would ask Laurie to put something together about that. And that's where the proposed P1 2016 came.
I believe he's confused.
Came.
I think that was me. So I asked for that, for Laurie to put something together a couple of years ago. And
I'm talking about last month. Oh, not, no. So
that was not
and
me.
And that's P1 2016 came out of that request.
Well, a couple of years ago, I did that very same thing, and this board voted against it only because they thought it was better on a street-by-street basis. So I know... Go ahead.
No, go ahead. You did, Mario. You absolutely did, and the board did say street-by-street basis. I don't know if I totally agree with that, but I was in agreement with you on that.
Yeah, it's just, I mean, it's true that on some of the streets in the township, you can, like on my street, there's only parking on one side, and it's plenty wide and safe to be able to put a truck there, but there's restrictions on my street, so I can't park my pickup truck, which is not a, you know, it's not a monster. It's just a regular daily driver. I can't park it on my street because of this restriction. But on other streets, if you had a big pickup truck, then you have an issue, especially with parking on both sides. So,
and what happens is if we restrict it, they just park around the corner on the next street.
Right.
And then you just get an ordinance the next block and the next block and the next block.
Similar
to parking permits by the train station.
Yeah, so. 4 years ago we had this issue in Lanark where we had a box truck that we literally chased around a neighborhood. I tried to put something together in this board, you know, and it's true. I mean, it's hard. Some streets are different. And some streets, people who own trucks like this can't park them in their driveways because they don't have driveways. There's no place for them to park. So it's a difficult situation. I don't know how you solve it.
Well, there's one situation we have to solve township-wide, and that's the definition of commercial vehicles. It has no weight limit. And our definition of commercial vehicles currently in our code is any vehicle with writing on it. And that makes no sense to me, that we're, you know, that there are streets in, you know, in the township where if you're driving a regular four-door sedan and it's got any commercial writing on it, it's banned from parking in your street, and yet somebody could park a 9,500-pound truck. So, and we've passed ordinances in the past where we've said no trucks are commercial vehicles because we're trying to get rid of trucks, you know, and we're trying to get rid of big commercial, you know, huge trucks that block people's views, and we'll end up, you know, hurting other residents.
But with vans, and just let me put this, just let me say this, with vans aren't trucks. So they fall under another classifications. So if you would have writing on the side of a big, huge van, it would still not be considered a truck, not fall under that the designation of a truck, but it would fall under commercial vehicle. That's where it gets all, I'm not disagreeing with you, Larry, I agree. I think, but it's just hard to define that. It's hard to define what...
I mean...
Or you could have a driving school car. And that falls under commercial.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. You could leave your sticker from your real estate agency and you'll violate commercial vehicles. So, and I can't tell from this ordinance where else, if we're just getting rid of any restrictions on, we still talk about commercial vehicles, but I don't see any definition of commercial vehicles. There.
It is in there.
Any motor vehicle used in a commercial business or enterprise on which appears advertising or identification of a business or enterprise. And I don't understand what we're trying to accomplish in that, except somebody not wanting, you know, to see any cars with writing on them.
I think you forgot to read the exception in that ordinance says, and with a gross vehicle weight in excess of 9,500 pounds or a height exceeding 84 inches.
Well, right now it's changed to enter,
right.
And I appreciate that. We've been talking about this for a long time. The first I saw this was, you know, when we got the agenda. We've all gotten a ton of email from people about being concerned about changing certain neighborhoods and certain areas in the town. I've got restrictions all over the 6th Ward. I've got skinny little streets. I've got a lot of streets that only have one side of the street parking. I have quite a few streets without driveways. So And, you know, we have a lot of people here who make their livings in using their commercial vehicles to do so.
Yeah.
And suggesting that they live, you know, three blocks from main thoroughfare where they could park their truck and they have to walk home every day or night, that's just not, we have to figure this out. And I don't think, I think this is a good start, you know, start of the conversation. And I guess we received in our packets material about what one of our neighbors does. Was it Radnor or who was it?
We have a couple of them. There's Radnor, there's Lower Murray and Springfield. Yeah. And what they do.
The problem is, like, there are certain streets in my ward that if you have vehicles or trucks that exceed a certain limit, the plows can't get up the street if it's snowing. It's very difficult for the plows to get through or emergency vehicles to get by. So that's another consideration. That's something else we need to talk about. How do we deal with that if we allow trucks of a certain weight to be parked in the street? How do we deal with the snow and emergency issues?
But I don't find that just
these
with
trucks.
Trucks
have a problem with length.
Oh, no, no. It's not with just with trucks. If you look at Westgate Hills, just take Westgate. And actually, I was talking about the other side of my ward. But if you just take Westgate, our police chief and Bill, he'll tell you, we've had difficulty getting up the streets with cars or SUVs parked on both sides.
But I think snow is a different is another issue.
It's a different animal, but
I mean, but the everyday
everyday two-sided parking in Steve's neighborhood is a severe challenge to getting a fire truck and an ambulance down the street.
About it. It's very difficult,
right?
Very difficult.
And some of these SUVs, like we're talking about restricting trucks of eight, you know, of 11,000 or below, which I think is ridiculous. But
high,
yeah, it's ridiculously high. Yeah. But if you take that, and some of these SUVs are built on truck platforms. So if you take a Cadillac Escalade or
a Yukon,
or a Yukon, these things have a bigger GVW than some of these, a larger GVW than some of these pickup trucks that guys are can't park on that street, and they're longer and bigger. So parking on that street with two of those SUVs side by side, you might as well have pickup trucks parked on both sides.
What does Lower Marion do, Chief? Do you know?
I don't know.
We find out.
Well, they have it here in the packet.
The streets with
Nate.
Gold.
They widen the street when it gets too thin.
Here. Huge driveways and yards in the back where they can put their
Commissioner McCluskey has
cars
a,
and big parking lots.
That's what
Lori
said.
Can I just say, it was about, I don't think any of you were here or realized what went on 35 years ago, but Mr. Kapushtin brought up an ordinance that basically banned trucks and vehicles from anywhere on any of the streets in Haverford Township, similar to what Springfield has. All right, Mr. McDonald, sitting right where Mr. Wexler is, seconded the motion to get it on the table so they could vote on it and vote it down, which they did. They voted 8-1. Ben was the only one that voted for it. Then they came up with 175-28, which is basically the parking on different streets. The neighborhood has control over each and every one of their streets. They make a determination on that block. Somebody went up and down the block 20-some years ago, we'll say on Ridgeway Road, took up a petition, no parking of commercial vehicles or trucks. And it passed. Okay, they got most of the neighbors on the street, 90% of them signed it. All right. Now, if somebody moves in on Ridgeway Road and has a truck, or any other street in Haverford Township and has a truck, they have every right to go up and down their block and ask that they have a sign put up allowing trucks. Now, they have to get the 75%, we'll say, to get to the fact of us presenting an ordinance in that fact. But that's basically the way it works. And this is street by street in Haverford Township. And I'll be honest with you, I don't know how many of you have had major problems with people. I can tell you this has worked for 30-some years. I don't know why you want to change it.
Well, I know with the street by street issue, there are 495 homes just in the Chatham Park neighborhood that have shared drives. And there are pickup trucks, there are vans. I do believe one of the exceptions is if you have a van, a special van dealing with the handicap. But if there are conversion vans, there's SUVs, large SUVs. So the average household might have 2-3 vehicles and they share a driveway and get one vehicle in the back on each side. So if no one on those streets has an issue with Mr. Smith or you know, Mrs. Jones parking a truck on that street, then I don't see an issue. So that's why I think it should go street to street.
Leave it the way it is.
And leave it the way it is. Yeah. That's the thing. I mean, there's a lot of homes, and that's just the Chatham Park section.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't disagree with that. It's just so it's hard to define what the number is, and then you have to, you know, if you say 8,000 GVW and below, then you're including things that you may not want to, like large SUVs that are going to that it's going to be worse. So I think we just do it street by street.
I think there's 24 letters between A and Z. I mean, doing this street by street has resulted in a lot of difficulty in a lot of neighborhoods. Doing this township wide might not be the answer, but I mean, tonight the question simply shouldn't be, do we leave everything as it is? And the Sixth Ward is a crazy motley assortment of, you know, this sign versus that sign, this side of the street, the other side of the street. And Jimmy, I'm sure you went up and down.
Well, Larry, somebody did some homework in your ward to get those signs up and down. I mean, they didn't just appear there, so you probably presented them, or one of your six ward commissioners presented them, and that's why they're there.
No, but my point, Jimmy, is that you may have done that, but we don't have any record here of the police getting 75%, you know, percent of every resident on every street to agree to the signs. We put signs up every meeting. And I haven't, I mean, there's signs that aren't an issue. Make sure we've got no parking zones that are big enough. Make sure we have special purpose handicap zones.
But are you saying you don't want the majority of the people on the street not to have a say in what goes on in their street?
I'm
because it doesn't make sense
only,
to me.
Only when it's public safety. We need standards. We need to have a set of standards that govern the town. And so that there is an arbitrariness. To
it's right here, 175-28. I mean, there's a lot of streets that have no signs on them. That means you can park anything on them.
Yeah.
And the people on those streets have no problem at all.
Well, we don't know that.
Well, I'm just saying, you know what I mean by that. You can park
as it is you can't park an 11,000 gross vehicle weight on the public on the street overnight now.
But you can park vehicles on a lot of sections.
Lori, isn't that number 13,000? Overnight parking is 13 grand? I think 11,000 is.
That's the proposed.
I think that's what
175,000 in your zoning code.
It's what?
In zoning, it's 11,000.
It's 11,000 in zoning. Okay, because it's 11,000 in this.
To match the zoning, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, do we know what Springfield and Radnor and other townships are doing?
Yeah, it's in your packet. The ordinances were presented.
It's not in my packet.
It was emailed.
I didn't see it. Okay. So, what? Just tell me what they are. I mean, what are they?
Right. Springfield is the most restrictive.
I can tell you. I went through the Springfield when they did this. It was a series of meetings that were held. And it was not a one meeting thing, and the idea that was behind that ordinance was to try and come to an ordinance that protected the health, safety, and welfare, while at the same time protected the people's rights to earn a living and operate their cars and as we said, like driving car commercial vehicle, what you would call a commercial vehicle as a driver's ed car or something like that, and what. The focus of the meetings were when that ordinance was passed was, first identifying what the problems were that they had in the township. And some of the problems were, like Commissioner DiMillo said, you know, getting down the street, getting fire vehicles down the streets. Then there was other concerns about, you know, vehicles that were parked in the front of the houses, like in the driveways that were big trucks with ladders and things like that on them, were sometimes blocking some of the first responders' views of the addresses on the houses and those types of things. So then, after we identified a bunch of the problems, and that took a few meetings to do that, then kind of work back the other way. Okay, well, how can we solve this problem? With the least amount of restrictions that we could, even though it looked like a lot of restrictions, and that's the way we came to that ordinance. And it's somewhat similar to this. I couldn't recite it for you off the top of my head, but there's a weight limit to it.
500 pounds.
Yeah, and there's a weight limit to it, and there's restrictions on, what can be on top, like ladders and things that would block the views of street sign or of street number, house numbers, those types of things were all prohibited. So that's the way it came about.
I'm clearly concerned about trucks that have ladders on them that are parked outside, and I think it's unsightly, and there are issues of safety and whatnot. But what about trucks? I mean, SUVs. I mean, there's some huge SUVs.
And I think that's where definition comes.
Yeah, I think that's what Commissioner Holmes might have been alluding to as well, as and Commissioner Oliva when saying that some of the Escalades and things are just
bigger
as big.
Than pickup trucks.
You really don't want to go at it. I don't think from an aesthetic point of view, because what's nice to one person is not nice to another person. Size, if you look at the size of the vehicle, if it's bigger than an Escalade, you got to figure out what the limit is, and that whatever the limit is, whatever you're prohibiting, should be directly related to the health, safety, and welfare, and not because the one truck is big. If you had one truck that was big and what you might consider ugly next to an Escalade, but they were the same weight, same
That's
size,
my
and
point.
All.
I mean, if you have a truck I used to have a truck. I love their trucks. I mean, Chris has a beautiful truck. You do too. You have the black one, don't you?
Yes, I have the black one.
Parking that, I think that kind of a truck on the street, it's a little different than parking trucks with ladders and whatnot.
Yeah, that's why my suggestion to you
is as big as SUVs. They're almost as big as Escalade.
My suggestion to you would be that you identify first what your problems are, and what problems are we trying to solve here?
Yeah, that's an excellent point, Mr. Byrne, and that was the point I wanted to make. If you're saying first responders can't see the numbers on people's driveways, well, I hope in 2016 that's not an issue. That every time we have an address, our first responders know exactly where that address is and get to it with their GPS or whatever. If you say that the size of the car blocks your ability to see somebody's house numbers, then you can't have parking on the street at all, unless you're going to say no car over 46 inches in height. So that's not going to happen. And then when you say Chris has a nice truck, but the dude down the street who's got a ladder on the side of his doesn't, then you're just getting into aesthetic,
because the
eyes of the beholder stuff.
It's a little different because the ladders are sticking out.
Well, the ladders might be sticking out. The ladders might be over the top. The ladder might be on the ladder might be on the sidewalk side as opposed to the street side.
Still might present more of an issue than an Escalade.
But what issue? That's the key. Is that you have to decide what's the harm we're trying to fix, and how do the different neighborhoods deal with it? In what neighborhoods is that harm okay? In other neighborhoods, that harm is not okay. Where we've got really tight streets and a lot of cross streets, in such as your ward, Mary, or my ward, where we need more room to be able to see. Do we have to have greater restrictions? Where you've got single side of the road parking, so it's easier to plow there because you can go to the curb, but you got double side parking. Do you have to be more careful about the width of the car? Because a truck could be 26,000 pounds, and if its wheelbase is no wider than a typical SUV, then it's not going to cause any problem with regard to plows.
Do we open ourselves up for lawsuits from one street to another? I would think we would.
Lawsuits?
No, I don't think so.
For like discrimination?
Sure.
No.
Why wouldn't we? If one,
because nobody has it. Nobody has a constitutionally protected right to park a certain car on a certain street. It doesn't matter. There's a distinction that, as long as we can articulate any distinction in something that doesn't involve a suspect classification of people or a constitutionally protected right, you don't have to worry about discrimination. It's not an issue. Really, it's not. You take Mr. Byrne's word for it if you don't take mine.
I can tell you that it's an issue in terms of you're going to hear a lot of people.
Oh, you're going to get a lot of grief. Yeah.
I know that in Springfield that we have had a couple different challenges to the ordinance from different folks.
Well, one of the problems with the Springfield ordinance, and I'm sure you had nothing to do with it, Jim, is that the Springfield ordinance bars it everywhere except where we put signs up to allow you to do it. So that creates a whole new kettle of fish for this board to deal with. If we ban all the parking, And then everybody comes to us and says, well, we need it on our street. We need to be able to park.
So it's permit parking.
Well, actually, the Springfield ordinance
has. It's almost permit parking.
I just want to make sure that it's clear because I don't, if it's going out to the public. The Springfield ordinance has been challenged several times, and the township was always successful in defending it.
Sure.
So, I mean, I don't think that, you know.
Right, and like, as I just said, we won't we'll succeed in any discrimination fight. But what the Springfield version of doing this started with a complete ban. And then said, you can seek, you know, basically you can designate areas as places you can do that parking. Well, good luck to the commissioner who proposes that in their neighborhood where they got rid of all truck parking.
In my neighborhood, that would be certain death. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, so, and, you know, and there are a number of our streets that should not have two side parking, but, you know, we're not going to change that. In the next, you know, in my lifetime, to one-sided parking. Every one of those streets is full at night, right? I mean, Steve, you've got a ton of it. Streets in your town you wanna turn to one side of the street parking? I mean,
we have a lot in my ward where you have one side parking, but you don't have a driveway either. So,
but what we should all agree to do, if we're gonna get rid of some of our double-sided parking, is that whatever commissioner lives in that ward votes no, and the rest of us all vote yes, so they have some political cover. Because anybody who loses two sides of the street, I mean, Belmont just did it because they had so many accidents and they were losing so many mirrors, and it was right next to a school.
Well, we looked
those
at
people
it,
had driveways.
We looked at it as an issue years ago. Mary, you thought it was an issue. You tried to do it township-wide.
Yeah.
And, Bill, you agreed, right?
I think the distinction is you can have 75%. You can have an activist or anybody go to my block and get 75%, and then we automatically change an ordinance to supersede what the township is. I think this belongs. I wasn't expecting an ordinance to be passed. This is going to take months. I think this belongs in the ordinance committee in conjunction with the police department to be studied. And the ordinance committee should then present this to us. Mm-hmm. Because there's a big distinction. In your street, you also have the right. You live in a residential neighborhood. Our zoning codes also prohibit commercial vehicles from taking away my residential life. So even though I install telephones, I'm a trades guy as far as a company. There might be a case where I bring a truck home, but I park it in the back of the house because I don't want to degrade my street by putting a commercial vehicle for a couple of days on the front street or overnight. There might be one exception, and there are exceptions. If a tradesperson has to take a truck home because he's got a long thing, but we have to look at this in a fair and balanced manner. Pickup trucks they're cars today. I mean, there's people in my street that use a pickup truck. They're four-door, they're two-door. That is a kid. Kids driving to school. So the part isn't restricting all trucks, but if somebody's running a business and parking four commercial trucks in front of my house, I'm going to be upset because that takes away from my ability to host my relatives. Sunday afternoon, I can't have my family for dinner. Thanksgiving gets screwed up because there's four trucks in front of my house that are there for business purpose. We don't pave our streets to be a parking lot for commercial properties, for commercial businesses.
Right. And what I was proposing four years ago was the pickup truck, the personal pickup truck, pickup truck that is under 8,000 GVW, which would be something that you would, you know, an F-150, a 1,500.
An F-250 is under 9,500 now.
What's that?
An F-250 is under 9,500,
right?
According to,
but I'm saying 8,000 and under, above 8,000, you would be under the restriction. I'm saying anything 8,000 and below. I mean, the pickup truck I drive is 6,800. So
miraculously below 8,000.
Yes, miraculously below 8,000. But that number is a half ton pickup or below. Right. Anything above that, you start getting into 3/4 ton. And commercial, commercial.
You got to be careful now because as Chief Viola's memo that came to us this afternoon points out, half ton, quarter ton is a misnomer. That's payload. Right. That's not gross vehicle weight. It has nothing to do with gross vehicle weight. That's your payload that you can carry. I can carry a half ton of.
No, gross vehicle weight is gross vehicle weight.
It's separate. Weight. It's separate from the definition of a half ton pickup.
Right. When they talk about it for selling purposes.
Yeah, for selling purposes, the designation of a 1500 compared to a 2500, a 1500 could have a diesel motor in it and have carrying more leaf springs. And it has has a higher GVW than a 2500 pickup, which doesn't have that. So, I get what you're saying, but the GVW is what it is.
I'm just going by what our police department has sent to us.
Yeah. I agree with what this police department says.
Mr. President, can I suggest that we follow Commissioner Wexler's suggestion that we turn this over to the ordinance committee for study and recommendation?
As it stands right now, then, ordinance number P1 2016, under the general laws of the township, chapter 175, subsection 175-28, the text that is before us will pretty much is dead, and it'll go to the ordinance committee for further investigation.
This is a work session, so it's not really before us.
No, but what I'm saying is that you're telling me that this is where it's going to go.
Yeah, I'd like to see something come out of the ordinance committee that takes into account points of Mr. Holmes, Mr. D'Amelio, and both sides of it, because I don't think we can continue by every block, 75% of people say can make an ordinance change every week, every month when we vote. So,
and to change the subject back to what Commissioner Wexler said at the beginning, an area that, and I'm not going to talk about the trucks, that we have not addressed that was much more volatile a couple of years ago is the issue of what I call parking zoning near the Route 100 in those areas where I thought DVRPC was going to assist us or something. Mr. Gentile, remember?
They've still been working on it. We haven't had an update in a while, but they are.
Yeah, I'd love to hear. I mean, I still get periodic complaints. It doesn't seem like the problem is quite as exigent as it has been, but it's still an issue. I don't know. We talked about that. I think
the issue being the permit parking in the area.
The permit parking near the stations, and then you ban it on one street, and so people park on the next street, and then we ban it on that, and we just push the problem rather than try to address it. I don't know what the answer is, but I know it really hasn't worked well. You know, the people, I guess, who
well for who
for the commuters in the township who don't always have the ability to park.
It right, has, but a neighborhood is still a neighborhood.
Correct, but if you buy a house next to the Route 100, you should expect commuters.
I disagree. Darby Road, people buy homes on Darby Road. Darby Road, when they first moved there, was two lanes. Now it's a four-lane highway. At some point, you have to say, this neighborhood is not a public parking lot. So therefore, the SEPTA needs to take a serious look at it and say, okay, we need to start putting in some parking areas here.
Every street in our town that doesn't have a parking restriction is a public parking area. Any car can sit as long as it wants, as long as it's registered.
Correct.
And insured. And so, I mean, so the idea that, you know, I mean, I get calls from folks saying, you know, this car's been there a week, or this car's been there, you know, or this car from somewhere else. And, you know, it's somebody visiting, or it's somebody has a new car, or whatever it is, but people, you know, mad that somebody else is parking on their street. Until we go permit parking in all of Haverford Township, we have to face the fact that parking on our streets is a public right, Commonwealth-wide, not just Haverford-wide. And the idea of this neighborhood needs to be protected from commuters, you know, we're going to say this neighborhood needs to be protected from overflow traffic in the Oakmont Business District if we want this to build up. Are we going to say this neighborhood needs, we have neighborhoods that are permit protected now because they're around schools and we don't want the kids parking near them. And that grows until there's finally going to be about four blocks where you can park in this town if you don't live somewhere or in a couple parking lots. And, you know, that's just not the way to go. I mean, I agree with Mr. Siegel entirely. That approach is not a 21st century approach, and we got to think about it.
I agree. We have to think about it.
We may think differently.
I mean, we have a lot of issues. And I totally agree with you. If you have somebody who's parking vehicles, trucks that are taking up all these spaces and ladder trucks and what kind of truck, I mean, it's just going to stop. How do you have people from visiting? It's just a problem.
Okay. But one of the things we face in our town is how many people their car is their commercial vehicle. And not just their driving instructing vehicle, but it's a truck. It's a decent-sized professional truck that isn't as washed as every other truck. It's used. It's used professionally. Now, what are we going to do about that person who lives, you know, in Ardmore, lives in the center of Havertown, and he paints, or he's a contractor, and his only truck is his professional truck? I mean, he can't park on his street. He lives on a street that doesn't have driveways. Are we going to make exceptions for these folks or tell them they can't live in these neighborhoods?
Well, that's what I'm saying. There's no good way to...
That's what we have to understand.
If they're running a business, we
have that every time we make one of these restrictions in one of these neighborhoods, when, you know, whether it's 75% of the neighbors or whether it's just, you know, commissioners gotten a bunch of calls or whether we're just extending a parking restriction another block, you know, that's the human cost of each of these restrictions.
But understand that when you do something like this, street by street, you're pushing one. So I can't park on this street. I'm going to go park on somebody else's street. That's what you're doing.
That's my point.
And that's his point. He's right.
My daughter on Penfield would agree with Chris because I can't get in and out of their driveway when I'm picking up my grandchildren to get in because the commuters are parked tight right up against their driveway on Penfield. So they've been pushed back by permit parking into that street. So now they're getting a petition together to get 80% of people to go permit parking. So
it's my job to voice the words of the people.
I agree.
Yeah, all right, so this is going
to go...
This is going to go to the ordinance committee, and also included in there, I guess we're going to have what the definition of a commercial vehicle is. So if there's no further discussion on this, because we're continuing to talk over what we just talked over, it'll go to the ordinance committee.
Okay, but I just wanted to add that if just say... on Ridgeway Road, the people there have the signs up, and basically somebody moves in or four people move in, they have trucks. They would like to change the ordinance. There's nothing stopping them from going to each and every neighbor and saying we'd like to change the ordinance. That's neighbor to neighbor. Now, if they get the right amount, whatever that is that you guys say, that's one thing. And if they don't get it, then it stays the way it is. I don't understand why we're trying to fix something that isn't broken. I guess I should put it that way.
Okay. Thank you very much. And this one as before us then goes before the ordinance committee. Discussion is over. I'm going to go to the next week's agenda. Does anybody have any questions, concerns about anything for next week's agenda? We have... three ordinances that are second readings, and then we have several resolutions, one which were discussed earlier.
You got the...
we have the declaration of snow emergency. That's taken care of. And then we have purchase of vehicles, public works, parking, or park maintenance, and police department. Is there a discussion?
Sure.
Was the...
a lot of vehicles were buying.
Yeah.
I have a question. I do have a question about the vehicles, Chief.
Yep.
So the four that were buying the Tahoes and the one Explorer, so what is the average lifespan of one of our vehicles? Is it based on number of years or mileage that we have?
Can I jump in there too?
Yeah.
The way we do it with our police vehicles, they'll probably be used throughout the township. So they may get 5 years, 6 years... and patrol, then they go down to investigations, then they go to codes, then they go to park. So we get an average, I would say 15 years.
15 years out of a vehicle?
We'd probably go 150,000 miles.
Yeah. Even the Chevy, like Tahoes that we're buying?
They'll last even longer because they are.
And they go down through the ranks as well, the same way?
Oh, yes.
Police cars. Yeah,
okay. That's a good return on investment.
Definitely. I always applaud our mechanics. They're the ones that keep it running, and they do a great job. Because I speak to other police departments, and they might get 5-6 years before they send them out to pasture. But our maintenance garage does an outstanding job keeping them up to where they should be.
We have our codes vehicles that we have now. They're actually were used as paramedic vehicles for 6 years, and they were taken and stripped down, painted, and then. It's nice having all-wheel and four-wheel drive vehicles for our code inspectors. So that historically they were grounded when we had the old Crown Vicks and we were using them. Now that they're out in the snow and help enforcing the ordinances of snow emergencies, things like that.
Now with the SUVs, we don't have to put chains in any car, so it's a big savings there also.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Chief. Thank you, Larry.
You're
okay. Any discussion on the highway trucks?
Could I make just a comment?
Yep, absolutely.
We normally, a lot of these vehicles, for example, the highway department, you'll see the bucket truck and then our trash truck. We order all the vehicles in the beginning of the year as quick as we can. It's all done through CoStars. First come, first serve. Some of these vehicles, for example, the bucket truck, which is the tree truck, it's a vehicle we use every day. It's an essential piece of equipment. We won't see that until October. Same thing with the trash truck. We won't see them. We have to get these vehicles ordered. So Amy's department, our finance department, we will not be paying for these until they actually arrive. Usually the police vehicles arrive within
2 months.
Two, 3 months. So it's several months down the road is when we start paying out for these. We have to get them ordered. So. And they are all budgeted. Give you a little information. I think of all the highway vehicles, the police department, we're about 60. It's actually $67,000 less than what we budgeted, but we still have to, when the vehicles come in, we have to strip them down, move them over, all the cameras, the radios, the lights, the sirens. There's an expense there, but it'll still be under what we budgeted. And the public works vehicles, all the park maintenance and public works vehicles are roughly about $10,000. The cost is about $10,000 less than what we budgeted.
So Larry, given what you said, are these all the vehicles that we intend to purchase for this year?
Yes, all the major vehicles. And there may be some minor equipment things that we have to, that we're looking to purchase, but this is the essential vehicles that we will order this year, yes. In fact, there are no other vehicles.
If there are no further discussions, I do have one question. Mrs. Widop did have wanted to discuss a matter on, was it legal or real estate, or do we need to go back into an executive session? We cut short before this meeting.
I thought we were going to reschedule.
All right, we're just going to go ahead with next month.
Next Monday night.
Okay.
Okay. You okay with that?
Entertain a motion.
I want to bring up one other issue.
Okay.
Is it okay?
Absolutely.
For years, we've been having these work sessions, and they've been moving along pretty quickly. And I think it's high time we take a look at it and see if it's really necessary to continue having work sessions, or whether just to go back to one meeting a month and keep open a Monday, so that if we do need a work session for something that may be a little controversial or may take a little time, we have that Monday open. But it seems to me that we are, you know, these work sessions, this is probably one of the longest we've had in a while, but they're ending very quickly, and it's costing us money to even have these work sessions. I think, what was the estimate? Do you have an estimate, Larry, about what it could be running here?
I think when we looked at the cost, it was roughly about $10,000 a year for the year to have Monday night meetings.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not saying not to keep a Monday open. Keep a Monday open that if we do need to have a work session, that Monday's open and we can say we're going to have a work session about this A, B, or C issue. We have it there. We're ready to go. Other than that, I think it's been rather quickly. They're moving fast, and quite frankly, we're discussing the same thing at the regular meetings anyway. We're discussing it over and over again. So that's my thought, to go back to one meeting a month, and to keep a Monday open. Keep this Monday open so that if we do need to have a work session, we have it. It's there. It's available. We just go, okay, we're going to have it next Monday. We're going to have it the following Monday.
Mr. President, Mr. DeMille, are you done, Commissioner?
Yes.
One of the reasons we had work session, we came up with the idea of a work session, was that people could hear a week before the meeting what was on the agenda and actually hear the thoughts of the commissioners, so that by the time somebody got up and spoke at the meeting next week, they will have had the opportunity to watch this meeting or come to this meeting. And all of us will have had an opportunity to see and evaluate an ordinance or a resolution before we come to the board. If we're doing things quickly now, that's great. there's no need to go over at the official meeting over and over all the arguments that were, you know, raised or brought up at the work session. And the work session, really, the function of the work session with us taking no action here is to honestly debate an issue and perhaps change our minds in the week between Mondays, where from the initial position we might have taken on something. And I think just the fact of that we are working quickly now is more a product of the work sessions and the different way we do things now. And taking them away would be a big mistake. As it is, I believe we only have 10 working sessions scheduled this year anyway, because we don't have one in November traditionally, and we're probably not having one in September or October. I forget. One of those 2 months we've lost a work session.
Yeah, I think it's October and November.
But we are discussing the same issues, and when residents are here at this meeting, they can't speak, and they are able to speak at the regular meeting, and when they do, we tend to allow them to speak, and then we respond to those questions and those comments, and it's repeating what we've already have accomplished. But if it's something that is going to be highly controversial, we can't keep this meeting open. I just think,
phenomenon. Having people going over everything again at the second meeting is not necessary. The township manager and the board president traditionally have been the people to answer or respond to questions that are raised by the public. And then if the questions were significant enough on agenda items, it comes up in our agenda discussions. But it's up to us to regulate how we're going to handle things at the regular meeting, whether we're going to go over the same tired ground or whether we're going to the person who's in favor of the ordinance or who sponsored the ordinance present it, say this is why it is. We talked about this last week. And, if somebody wants to state the reasons for or against it and we proceed, we can proceed. That was our goal when we came up with a work session versus an official session, was that we were going to be much more ceremonial in the official sessions and we were going to be much more bare-knuckle in the work sessions.
But see, so I don't see it as the same. I'm sorry.
No, I'm done.
I'm going to say it's actually going back and forth. Is there anyone else wishes to weigh in on this discussion?
Mr. McCluskey.
Well, as a perspective from someone who's new to this board, I think quite clearly, as people indicated regarding the trucks, most of us got several emails on this matter, and we were able to discuss it at this meeting tonight, and we were able to hash out different viewpoints and then put the issue for further discussion within the ordinance committee. If that had only taken place at the regular meeting, we would have spent a long period of time, certainly, with the public giving out their opinion and arguing over something that didn't need to take place. If anything, we saved time by having that. And in reality, from someone who wasn't on this board last year, having the work session to identify the issues that this board is actually going to discuss and vote on the next week is beneficial to the community in terms of whether they want to actually attend and comment the next week.
Right, but
so there's a value there for the constituents as well.
But it seems to me that people from that street showed up tonight and weren't able to talk. But had they been able to speak at a regular meeting, who knows what would have happened then at that regular meeting?
Yeah, but they're... their ability to talk is restricted to agenda items only. We take the formal, as I forget the term Larry used, but the more ceremonial approach. We would have to bring it up. It would have to be a motion. We'd have to entertain discussion, which could go on for 45 minutes on what a truck, a commercial vehicle is. So, but we also have to give them the ability, and we have to vote. We have to listen to them before we vote. We haven't even had a discussion. So the public forum is before our discussion would happen, because the agenda item only discussion comes before we even bring it up. So we lose the opportunity to debate among ourselves and talk about that as well. And then I'm a firm believer that the public meeting is for the public to come and voice their opinion on those items that we're going to vote for that evening. And we get to hear them before you make your final decision. And
well, I made my comments.
I would just echo what Commissioner D'Amelio said. I mean, I served on this board for 4 years, and we had one meeting a month, and I think we did it very, I mean, they were lengthy meetings. I personally would prefer, and I think the public would prefer, and I think we can save money by having one meeting a month. because we're going to be here next week, and this meeting next week shouldn't last more than 5 minutes, other than public comment.
Right.
So it seems to me that we should have public comment up front on any agenda item or any issue up front, and then get into the agenda, and vote, because I think that's the more efficient way to do it. It's one less night out for Lois. It's one less night out for the rest of the staff. I think we save money, and it's a more efficient way to do it. I don't think there's any, you know, be reason not to do it that way. It was done efficiently that way before and effectively, and I think I share his view. That's just my personal
Commissioner
view.
Lewis, I was here till 2 o'clock in the morning at one of those meetings during
that doesn't bother me at all. I don't mind.
It's a totally different era.
That was totally different. But I would rather spend another hour and a half here.
But why we did work sessions was because we had so many meetings where the only discussion, the only time we even found out on the board that something was on the agenda was 2 days or 3 days before the meeting. Or in some situations, it got put on the agenda when we walked in, and it was on the agenda. It was the first time we were seeing it. So you had to read it. You had to evaluate it. You had to listen to the public comment. Most of the public didn't know any of these things were coming up. So, I mean, one of the things we were accused of back then when I first got on the board was that nobody had an opportunity to comment intelligently because they
had no
idea what
the commissioners thought. I don't think they were accusing you or me. I think they were making those accusations
about
others.
Yeah, you know, about the system. And the system was that nobody knew. First of all, nobody knew what the commissioners thought until after they spoke, whereas, you know, next week they're going to get to see how various commissioners comment and may have gotten their questions answered. One of the things I think we've accomplished with work sessions is that I think we have fewer people who come here and comment on issues because those folks driven to do that watch and they see what people talk about in the work session and realize somebody already gets that. Somebody on that board is already thinking that way. And so, I mean, we don't get 25 people signing up for the public, you know, for the public comment on any topic.
Oh, you think it's because we're having these work sessions?
I think a lot of people are hearing us discuss an issue and hear it hashed out and are satisfied that it's being evaluated. Sure.
I think it's our job to stay, whether it's tonight or the regular meeting, until every question or every resident is satisfied, whether it is 2 o'clock in the morning or not. That's our job.
Our job is to do what's right for the town. We're not going to satisfy all our constituents.
We try to do it as efficiently as possible, but we're not being efficient now. I mean, we're wasting money right now. We're having these meetings. Barely anyone shows up anymore, and they're quick, and they're over with. And then we're discussing this same thing at the next meeting.
We discussed these conversations at the next commissioner's meeting. 10 years ago, these weren't on TV. Right. You had to go get a VHS to try to watch this thing. We now have DVDs. People are watching this on TV. Every one of us has constituents that write to us and said, I just watched the meeting, and they ask us questions. And people come to these meetings.
They've been watching them since I started running in 2003. Because they told me.
I think tonight is sort of a good example of why you need the work sessions. The truck issue. I probably received 25 or 30 emails about the truck issue. We discussed it tonight and determined that the appropriate thing to do was to send that to the ordinance committee. We've done this with other issues where people come in and we say, okay, a committee needs to talk about it or we need to go back and rework it. That is far more productive in both the short and long term than if we had simply put this on the agenda next week. Those people who wouldn't have known obviously it wouldn't have been taken off the agenda, they come. There's public comment, agenda items. We sit through a two-hour public comment session, and then we would have had the same discussion that would have ultimately led to tabling or removing the item from the agenda. This is a far more efficient way to deal with those types of issues. And yes, some months we don't have those issues, but when we do, it makes a difference. Plus, I really believe it's pretty clear that even though people don't come to the meetings, they get their news, and they get their information in a variety of ways. We are way past the days of just traditional newspapers. We see the demise of the newspaper. But all you have to do is go on to the internet. You'll see public comment, whether it is the newspaper's pages, whether it's Facebook. The truck issue is being heavily discussed. Snow removal and every type of issue is being discussed among people. And that's what generates, or I think generated, a lot of the emails I got on trucks. So I think we did a service to ourselves and the community tonight by discussing the issue and taking it off the agenda so that we didn't have to hear what I suspect would have been a large amount of public comment.
Okay, I agree with you, but that's what Commissioner D'Amelio is saying. If we have an issue that we need to discuss ahead of time, like this particular issue, we can save that Monday, and we can have that work session. If we're not going to have anything that we're going to, that 50 people or 25 people are controversial, why are we wasting the public's time and why are we wasting money? We can always put them in. We can always come up with those work sessions. We can always have one. If you have the issue, you can have it. If we don't have anything, then why are we continuing to waste money having the solicitor here, the engineer, our staff,
our police chief,
it's a waste of time. I mean,
if we know we're going to have a controversial issue and we want to call us, we have that meeting open, that's great, Commissioner. Yeah. We have it open, we have that discussion, we do it. No one's saying we wouldn't discuss
controversial?
It.
Who determines that it's controversial?
Step
we take.
The board does.
What if we don't think it's controversial?
Well, then it's not.
And then we find out a pile of people.
I mean, that's the whole point. It's not us to determine whether someone in the public wants to comment on it. Our job is not to make less opportunities for the public to get information or the public to comment. We're here to provide more information so they can then determine what is and what is not controversial. It's up to them, not us.
Yeah, we are at 70 minutes right now, okay? And we could have, had you not brought this up, left 15 minutes ago. And I'm glad you brought this up.
I'm willing to stay another 2 hours if you want.
Fine. No. You're not going to out-talk me. That's for sure. Okay? That's not going
to
happen.
I'm willing to stay another 3 hours. You want to give it a try? I'll do it.
Yeah. My point is that it isn't... We're not asking this much. I don't know where $10,000 a year comes from for having these meetings. A lot of things in this township cost a lot of money, okay? The work sessions, one of the most successful things we've done in the last 10 years, is change the way we do things, how transparently we do things, how cleanly we do things, all right? We're not adding things to the agenda at 1 o'clock in the morning like we used to. We're not proposing issues to the public for the first time. They've never heard it before, and we're bringing it up at a meeting and voting at it that night. We're not doing those things anymore. And the public now has a great deal of confidence in this board that it is talking about and deliberating these issues. And if that costs us an extra 90 minutes on the first Monday of the month, that's worth doing. Canceling these is a bad message to the people of this
town. I don't think it's a bad message. The public is fully aware, as Commissioner Siegel fully made us aware. You have Facebook that's out there. You have the blogs that are out there. People do know what's going on. It's not just like all of a sudden they're hearing about it on the Monday that we have it. And again, we're saying if there's something that needs to be discussed, we keep that Monday open and we have that meeting.
And we do have, just as much as we have, we want to have open discussion and have the public know what's going on. We don't want to waste money either if we're just going to be sitting here. I mean, right. that's
we're
a waste of public resources.
We're only having 9 work sessions this year. We're not having 10 because we don't have a work session in January. So we're only having February, March, April, May, June. We've canceled before in August just for the heat and not having anything to do. We already know we're not having one in October. We're not having one in November. I personally don't like that we're, that we're kind of
June,
we're not trying so hard to keep all of
graduation.
June's graduation. So, I mean, there's a variety of reasons we cancel work sessions. People in this town have gotten used to the work sessions. We as commissioners have gotten used to the work sessions. If it's a question of bridling us at the regular meeting, I'll make a commitment right now. I'll say everything I have to say during these work sessions, and as long as somebody doesn't say something completely nonsensical during the regular meeting, I'll shut my mouth.
You need to define nonsensical.
I'll lose that bet.
I usually have to respond to somebody, raising an issue.
It's almost worth keeping it.
But you need to define nonsensical for us.
Well, anything I don't agree with, obviously. I mean, that's what
that means.
Jimmy McGarrity.
I just want to say, after making over 250 meetings here over the years I've been on the board, I agree with Steve, Andy, and Mario that we can get by with the one meeting at the commissioner's meeting. We did that before. The reason these work sessions came about, we all know, was the Haverford Authority and the Haverford State Hospital issue. That's why they all came about, because of the 2 o'clock in the morning, 1 o'clock in the morning we were leaving here.
We have a lot of controversies over that. Right.
And that's the major reason. There was other reasons, but that was the major reason.
Work sessions were made formal around the time I joined the board, which is 7 years ago, because we voted as an you're free to disagree.
I'm just saying I didn't agree with it.
But
then,
the point is, it didn't happen in Haverford State, because I remember we discussed it as an experiment, and we discussed we would see how it worked, and that's what we did. We looked at it, saw how it worked. And we went from let's see how it works to formalizing it. And once we cancel the sessions, you're not going to simply just say, oh, you can come back next Monday and have a session, because at least for some of us, we may make other plans. And at that point, it doesn't become fair to the members or the public. Predictability is what they want from meetings and everything else, and you don't have that if we decide, oh, this month we're going to have a work session, and I don't know who's the arbiter of what is an issue that warrants a work session, because we have found, you know, suddenly there were rumors about pools, and we had lots of people here, so you don't know what is going to rile up the public and get them interested in a particular issue.
When I was against the work sessions, I was also concerned about the time that you changed the meetings, because of people that work and that want to get to the meeting and have a difficult time getting here. It's the same thing. You know, we, with social media being out there, you send out tons of emails. I send out emails about what's going on. People are aware. They're not being surprised as to what's happening in this township. Believe me, they're not. And they are on these works, on these blogs,
understand.
And they are discussing these issues. And again, if we need to go to a work session, we have the Monday open. If Larry, you would agree to keep it Monday open, right?
Yeah, we do.
Keep it open, and we come. We come here.
Time is my issue. And I've said that before. 7 o'clock.
The problem with
Chris. I don't know. What did you mean?
You said the time of
Chris prefers later meetings.
Yeah. Oh, I did too. And I said that because of the fact that there's a lot of parents that work, single mothers that work, some of them that want to come here, that want to speak, and it's very difficult to make the time that we set. And I think it's wrong.
We cannot, as a board, no more than 4 of us can ever discuss any issue except here in public and next week at the meeting in public, okay? That's the only time we can do that, okay? So the public gets to see us debate as a full body these different issues, all right? If we can do that twice a month instead of once a month, once to talk about the issue, convince one another of issues, hear other people's perspectives, and then at the next meeting vote at them, that's a great way of doing it. People see us do this. They see government in action. Next week is too soon. One time to read the ordinance, listen to public comment about it, and then vote on it is a mistake. That's why we created work sessions. So if people want to talk about what we did 10 years ago, What we've done in these last 7 or 8 years with work sessions has changed the public's view and the public's confidence in this board. And taking a step back from that
I think the board itself has changed the confidence. The board itself has. But we are having the same discussions next Monday. We don't just
go. We're not going to have this discussion.
No, through it.
So what we're saying next week should be literally. It should
not
be
on the agenda, so we're not discussing it next week.
It should be public
new business,
public forum, right? And then all these resolutions and ordinances, it's going to be, you know, a 30-minute
meeting. No, that's not going to be a 30-minute meeting. Let me tell you something. People, because nobody's going to speak. 2517 Bryn Mawr Avenue, people are going to show up. 1224 Steel Road, people are going to come. Anytime we do land development or do acquisition, people are going to come here with comments. I'm going to have people in the 6th Ward, you know, asking me about 2517 Bryn Mawr Avenue. We never have a 5-minute meeting. Every one of these things we do.
Amongst ourselves, we don't have comments or we don't have questions, right?
No, not yet. Yeah. But in some circumstances,
but
I mean,
we could deal with that in one meeting as effectively, I think. But that's just my view. So
it isn't about how much time it takes to do these things. It's about letting it percolate. It's about letting the. It's about reading about it in the newspaper. It's about seeing this meeting. It's about attending if it's an issue that matters to you.
I think Steve's point about, you know, I send out emails to 500 people, and I keep my constituents informed and. I think people know what's going on in this township, so
I don't think this is much more than seven years ago.
If we
much process,
to this.
Process would have to be that we got to come under new business, and then it would have to go for a resolution, because it was a resolution that we got us here.
I agree with that. Yeah, I think we had a resolution to establish the meetings, so we need a resolution to say.
We would need a resolution. Somebody would need to introduce that.
Next week.
Mm-hmm.
And you could take action on it.
Under new business, right.
Was it under new business or just a resolution?
We would do it under, either you have it on the agenda or you do it under new business, yeah.
Okay.
No further discussion?
Yeah, I just have one other thing. I don't know whether it's appropriate to talk about it now or next week, but the redistricting issue.
Yes,
you want to talk about that briefly now?
We just have to follow through with this redistricting. It's been on the board now for several years, three years.
Census was done in 2010, so it technically it should have been done.
There were injunctions in place for a long time before anyone could.
Okay, so I would could have been done in the last year or two.
I would like to reassign the redistricting committee and follow through with that.
Okay,
and then by the
come back to
this year.
Who's on the committee?
We should do it.
Well, it's.
It had been you, me, and Mr. Holmes.
Mr. Holmes is still on it. Mr. Lewis and Mr. Oliva will be on it. Because two of the people that were on it are no longer on it. Can no longer be on it.
So, excellent.
Okay. I just think we should try to get it behind us.
We can get together before the next meeting, regular meeting.
I think if you're just handing out a committee assignment, this is fine. Yeah.
We just need to know, I guess, from you, Jim, and get an opinion from your firm as to whether the deviations in population between the wards is within an acceptable range, which I think it is.
Yes.
But we need your opinion.
Right.
Yeah.
Mr. Lewis, you're going to lead that up?
Sorry?
You're going
to
lead that up?
I'd be happy to.
But for the purposes, and there's nothing, it's not subject to any executive privilege. The issue about the reapportionment in the last couple of years that we were looking at is that we aren't dealing with large deviations. What we're dealing with is geographic anomalies, but not demographic anomalies. So none of the 9 wards have wildly differing populations that require us to move them. But we still have these ancient, intrusions into neighborhoods and odd shapes to the shapes of the wards, so that, you know, my ward's got a piece of Merwood Park that it doesn't need and doesn't have Elwell. There's a piece of the 8th ward that cuts all the way into the 7th. So neighborhoods, you know, if you were to divide the township into 9 traditional neighborhoods and then try to even out the populations within them, you know, that could be one of the goals. But as far as, you know, reapportioning based upon the need to do so because our population demographics have changed within the confines of our current wards. They haven't. They haven't changed
and
enough
that was pretty
to compel
obvious,
us to
but,
do this.
But why didn't we move on it?
I still think you have to pass a plan, do you not?
You have
aren't
to
you
pass
required
a plan,
legally
right?
to pass a plan after a census is done?
I thought you had to.
I've got to go back and check on
that. I think that if you don't, that there's ways people can challenge it if you don't do it after a certain time. I think you do. I think the safest thing is to pass a plan.
That would put an end to it.
I'm requesting. Is anybody else requesting?
He's got.
I agree with you, Mr. President.
Yeah.
I'm glad Andy's back on. Maybe we'll get things started with Mario and Commissioner Holmes. We got to get it started.
We can finish it pretty quickly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anything for the betterment of the board?
I'll tell you, snow removal was absolutely great again, Larry. Congratulations to Doc and the Public Works staff. Great job.
So move.
Thank you.